Welcome to this BNP Paribas event, our Sustainable Finance and Jazz Evening. My name is Rob. I'm part of the recruitment team here at BNP Paribas. On the call as well, we have Head of Early Careers, Jessica Dyson, and my colleagues, Lenny and Emma as well. We also have Sarisher and Trevor from BNP Paribas, and we have Laurent here as one of our musicians from our foundation, and Suze from our media team. What we'll do tonight is we're going to go through a little bit about sustainability and sustainable finance here at BNP Paribas. You'll hear from two business speakers where they'll give a presentation. We'll then speak to Laurent about how he gets involved with the BNP Paribas Foundation, and hopefully he'll be playing some music for us as well during the evening. And then what we'll do is we'll go open to questions at the end of the evening, and you put it to the business. So no further ado, why don't we move over to Sarisher?
Great. Thank you so much, Rob, and to everybody for joining this evening. I think it's great to welcome you all, and apologies we can't meet in person, but I think hopefully that'll happen at some point soon. And I think it's great that you're connected to BNP Paribas and interested in sustainable finance. So I think the topic that I really wanted to talk to you all about today was how sustainability and climate change are really redefining economics in the markets. So a lot of people know that obviously working at a bank, you might think that it's at the heart of the economy. It's really central to the way that companies work and the way that money flows in the economy. But actually, I think one thing that's really interesting is that that is a byproduct of the factors that influence the markets and influence those companies as well. And sustainability and climate change are really becoming core parts of those discussions with the clients that we have here at BNP Paribas and also the wider ecosystem. And I wanted to talk to you today a little bit about that and also a bit about my career path of where I've got to today to hopefully be a bit helpful on some of the mindset shifts. Essentially, all of my career, I thought I really want to be an economist. I want to go work in the markets. And I did that. So I joined BNP Paribas as a graduate, and I had a long history with the bank. So I did spring week with the bank, where I didn't even know what investment banking was. I did the summer internship working in different desks like credit strategy and debt capital markets, and then I eventually found my place working on the macroeconomic research team. But I'd always had this inner desire to do something around finance. It's actually the reason why I joined in the first place was off the back of the microfinance projects. So I really thought that this was core to my career. And interestingly, an opportunity came about just before the big UN climate change summit that we all know as COP21 in Paris. A role came up and I thought, I really want to do that. So I decided to change role and work in sustainable finance communication. Where I still work today. So I work in the press team and also in the content and communication team for the corporate and institutional bank, so the higher kind of level of the global markets and then the investment bank. Essentially, where did my passion for sustainability start, you might ask? So I've always loved skiing and hiking and really threw myself into being in the mountains as a child. And so I think it developed from a love of nature. But I knew that you could use finance as something good. And I think it seemed apparent to me that the climate crisis really needed a huge effort from different actors. And so I wanted to go and learn more about what to do there. So I actually joined a course at Cambridge University for 2 years on the master's program in sustainability leadership, where I basically learned so much more about this topic and looked at how to embed that in my role at BNP Paribas. Part of that journey also involved several different projects, like joining the Al Gore Climate Reality Leadership, so the guy who was behind the Inconvenient Truth. So that was fascinating. So it was really to learn about what climate change is and crucially the economic and social impact of it. And then finally, talking to you here today, it's culminated in terms of my role at BNP Paribas, but also outside of the bank. It has been really encouraging as a result of the master's. So I had to do something at Cambridge that was setting up a personal leadership challenge. And being a skier and hiker, I thought, why don't I do a conference on sustainability in alpine tourism? So I've actually founded an initiative called SATI, the Sustainable Alpine Tourism Initiative. And it looks at how to engage stakeholders across the whole of the tourism industry on sustainability. And actually, sustainable finance is a core part of that. And take a look at my LinkedIn, because the first The second event will be on decarbonising infrastructure. And we've actually got a BNP Paribas head of company engagement, CIB, who's going to be speaking on that. So yeah, I think actively encouraged to share and to be part of the project. So I think the more dialogue we have on sustainability, the more collaborative it can be. This is a really interesting graph. So I'm not sure how well you can see it, but hopefully you can see the colours. So this is a risk indicator from the World Economic Forum. And every year they produce a report that says, what are the largest risks facing the global economy? And in 2007, 2009, all the way leading up to 2011, these were always economic. So that's the blue colours that you can see on the screen. And only in the last few years has climate change really become a head-on in terms of a risk to the global economy. And crucially, I think this particular report anchors so much strategy of different businesses in terms of addressing what the risks for their business are. And for the first time ever this year, all of the top five risks are actually related to climate and biodiversity crisis. So I think this isn't just something that is a passion for me, it's something that's really embedded into the global economy. And I want to explain a little bit about what that's meant for the bank and crucially for the industry as a whole as well. So I mentioned that I was trained by Al Gore on the Climate Reality Project. And I think that gave a very different perspective in terms of what the impacts of climate change are to not only understand the science, but also understand the economic impact. And I think it's a conversation that is often quite siloed. I think I'm very open and honest about that, that often when I speak to scientists and to different conservationists, they rarely ever speak to a banker about this issue. And I think part of our role at BNP Paribas has been to really bridge those dialogues and try and be a bank that actually thinks in a different way and crucially engages with society in a different way. What is actually shifting? Okay, so I said climate change is important. I said we care as a bank, but what's actually happening in the outside world in terms of the financial industry? So central banks is a really core cool part of this. So basically, years ago, central banks' mandate was primarily we're going to do price stability, look at inflation. But now that's completely changed. And I think the ECB is a prime example of this. So under the leadership of Christine Lagarde, they really put climate change at the heart of the agenda of the central bank. And I think me being an economist, very excited about that. And I believe Trevor's going to talk a little bit later about what that means day to day as well. Investors are really engaged as well. So you've got a whole host of different initiatives that investors are looking at decarbonisation and how to engage on climate risk in particular. You've got this amazing thing called the Science-Based Targets Initiative. So this is companies that are willing to disclose on science-based targets to actually say, how fast are we going to achieve net zero, for example? What does that look like? Where are we versus our industry? So finally, governments as well, I'd say, are really engaged on this. So the UK, I've put the Union Jack there because the UK actually put it legally in terms of their net zero target for 2050. So they're really engaging on this at a policy level as well. And I think that's filtering out into all of the different ecosystem stakeholders that we engage with. So this is actually a quote from our CEO, Mr. Jean-Laurent Bonnefé. And in terms of timing, this was from 2007. So this wasn't something this week. It's not something that we've been doing, this year. It's something we've been doing for the last, I'd say, not just the last 3 years, but really the last decade or more. So the bank has expanded green finance really to a stage that's mainstreamed into every major part of the bank. So not only is it a separate kind of team that looks at this, but it's embedded into the whole bank. Why is that? It's because essentially, if you're a bank, you sit at the heart of the economy. And in order to shift the economy towards a low carbon economy, you have to really integrate finance, green finance in particular, into the business model. And I think for this particular presentation, I focused on green. There is this whole agenda of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. I didn't want to go through that today because you could talk all day about that. But if you do want any details about that wider sustainability agenda, don't hesitate to get in contact with me. So I mentioned the SDGs, they're these 17 goals that were developed by the United Nations. But when you say things like the bank wants to solve zero hunger, it wants to solve climate change, it wants to solve zero poverty, it wants to look at clean energy, life under the ocean, biodiversity, how as a bank do you translate that? So what our sustainability teams did is they essentially took that UN framework and then they embraced it into saying, how does this apply to us as a bank? So how can we create products with a positive impact? How can we protect human rights through the policies that we have? So for example, how do we stop financing tobacco? How do we stop financing coal and tar sands? Can we look at policies to engage on renewable energy? Financial inclusion is also a really cool part. So we just won actually the world's best bank for financial inclusion. And that was really because in order to engage the whole of society in sustainable development, you have to not exclude many sections of society that might currently be excluded from the economic system. So that involves looking at microfinance solutions, looking at climate change adaptation financing, and giving people grants in, for example, Senegal with UN Women. So it's really looking at this whole challenge list holistically and saying, what can we as a bank do to support the effort around that? So specifically within the investment bank, we've got a dedicated sustainable finance program. So that really looked to establish sustainability at the core of the commercial offer of the bank. So how do we engage with our clients on this? What kinds of financing do we do? Can we do, for example, green bonds, green loans, sustainability linked products? And it's really started at the heart of understanding our clients' sustainability issues and then looking at what we as a bank can do to innovate on the financial offer to support them in that transition. So that's just a quick kind of overview of the program. So this is a fantastic report that I'd encourage you all to read. Slightly biased because it does come from Cambridge University, but it's called the Bank 2030 Report. And essentially it shows where are banks on the zone of basically making transition mainstream. And it identifies what banks need to do to shift towards a low carbon economy. And crucially, what role do they play in supporting that? And I think there's some fantastic research in there. Actually, you know, the researchers quite well that produced that report. And I think I'd strongly encourage you to look at that if you're interested in this discussion around banks and transition in particular. So I wanted to finish on some practical tips. So I've been at the bank for a while, not quite as long as other people, I would say. But I'd say that over those years, I've really tried to embrace sustainability in my role. At times, it wasn't even my role to do so, but I made it part of my job. And so I wanted to give you some practical tips about if you're looking at getting in this industry, what can you actually do to learn more about this? So one is follow influencers. I don't know if many of you have Twitter, but I personally never used Twitter until I worked in the press team. And now it's my go-to source for finding any information on things related to sustainability. You can create lists, follow hashtags, really try and engage in the conversation around who is actually following the topics that you're interested in. Read the news. So there's loads of free sites. You don't need to pay like, you know, hundreds of pounds a year to actually join a particular news site. ED is amazing. You just register and it's free to get this incredible news. You've got the Business Green Sustainable Development Goals Hub that was actually supported by BNP Paribas, The Guardian. I mean, there's so many different sites where you can read about sustainable finance and sustainability more generally. Events is a great one. So unfortunately, obviously, a lot of events are cancelled in person, but I'd say that it's created this raft of incredible webinars that are taking place on sustainability. And so, yeah, I'd encourage you to take a look at Eventbrite. It's really good to register for some of those and others as well that are coming up. And finally, match your passion. So a lot of people think that when they go and work in finance, you know, oh, I want to be a trader, I want to do this. But actually, I think the biggest thing I've learned is that you have to be adaptable in those roles and you have to crucially match your passion. Because if you're doing a job for the sake of the title, you're never going to really enjoy it because you're not actually matching it with your passion that's outside of work. And I think BNP Paribas as a bank is really at the forefront of engaging, matching people's values and their passions for sustainability with their job. So there's a whole host of initiatives that I could talk about on this, but essentially feel free to reach out because there's a lot of things where we've done, like, you know, competitions on the Arctic to get ideas for people to engage on climate change, and then they won a trip to the Arctic. There's things around volunteering for organizations that you care about. So we've really tried to make it that it's not a siloed part of the bank. It's really core to our identity, and crucially, it's core to our culture, which I would say is really, really different from many other companies out there, not just banks out there, but companies out there as well. And finally, to finish on that note, the bank recently announced its company purpose. So it's worth checking out on the website. But we actually aligned our company purpose to sustainability. And I think that's really refreshing to know that you work for an organization that actually cares about these issues, and not just cares for the sake of caring, but cares because we care for our clients as well. So it's a really nice symbiotic relationship on the sustainability side, but also as an employee. So yeah, that's it. If you want to get in touch, feel free to reach out. Twitter, LinkedIn, anything's fine really. But yeah, I put my details there, and don't be shy and don't hesitate to get in contact.
Perfect. Thank you very much. That's Sarisher. Trevor, I'll just get your slides up.
Perfect. Thank you, Rob. Just to give a bit of background around my role. So I had a bit of a different start within the bank. Basically, I started in 2008. If you remember anything about the history of 2008, that was the start of the credit crisis. So somehow I survived the credit crisis through the bank. And basically, I studied finance and I studied economics as an undergrad. And then I moved on and I got my MBA. So I was more or less built to kind of be in finance. However, around 2008 to 2013, I was kind of struggling for my identity about what I wanted to be doing in finance, really. I didn't really have a clear idea in my mind of why I was in banking. And at the time, I was basically developing products around measuring risk. So as part of measuring risk for portfolios, myself and a colleague who at the time was based in Singapore, he actually works with us here in London now, we were looking at different elements that we could actually add to identify risk inside of a company. And one of those elements was something called ESG. So ESG is basically its environmental social governance factors that we use to help increase our analysis of a company. So back in 2013, no one really understood what ESG was, but we kind of saw this as, okay, yes, we believe that climate, you know, humans are having an impact on climate change. This is going to be something that actually adds an exogenous risk factor that we're going to have to start to factor into our financial modeling. Now, at the time, in 2013, nobody wanted to talk to us inside the bank, or really even outside of the bank. Outside of the bank, occasionally you found someone that was kind of curious about it, but really, it was tough back then. But basically, what I did was, over and over again, I kept having these conversations about sustainable finance, ESG, and bringing it up over and over. 2014, I was able to actually find some conference organizers that wanted to hear about this topic, and I basically started speaking about ESG on behalf of the bank, and lo and behold, we actually got some clients that were interested. Once we got, Rish mentioned this, but in 2015, we also had the added benefit of having COP21, and off the back of that, the president of France at the time, François Hollande, actually reached out to our CEO, Jean-Laurent Bonnefay, and basically said, how is BNP Paribas going to help support France in this transition? So as part of that, we actually started to receive a mandate internally to focus more on sustainable finance. Now, 2015 was still early days and there wasn't a lot of uptake on it, but our clients were clearly getting more interested. And in terms of ESG, when we look at environmental, social, and governance factors, they're not necessarily always very clear or very well articulated. So back then in 2015, a lot of companies or a lot of investors were focused on the governance factors for companies and how to actually look at how strong is the governance inside that company. During that time though, in 2015, 16, 17, and 18, what we saw, and you can actually see it on this chart now in the top left-hand corner, is the rise of the green bond. And as the green bond rose, it actually helped to attract more interest towards the environmental score. And what was key here is the difference of a green bond is you actually allocate proceeds specifically to green projects, but you need to have a robust and transparent method to actually show that that capital is reserved only for green projects. And you actually have to show your analysis for how you determine what a green project is. So the framework is rather robust. And in that sense, we really had, by the time we got to 2019, the market take off. And you can see that reflected in all three of these charts, actually. On the left-hand side, as I was saying, that is the green bond growth. But on the right-hand side, on the top, what we're looking there is 2019 to 2020, we actually saw a 40% increase, 40, into specifically ESG equities at that point. And if we look at the bottom chart, we can actually see that ESG has been outperforming its peers. And not just recently, but before the downturn of this year, during the downturn, and in the recovery of this pandemic as well. So ESG has kind of taken on a view now almost as its own asset class in that sense. What we're looking at now and taking the next step forward is really the economics of ESG. So we can kind of show that there is outperformance there. We can show that there's risk mitigation. But the added benefit we have now is that renewable energy in terms of solar and onshore wind are actually economically competitive with fossil fuel energy generation. So this trend is only going to continue now, not purely because we want to save the planet, that's obviously part of it, but also because there is now an economic argument for it. That has never been the case before in the 7 years, almost 8 years that I've been involved in this now. Before, we did not have these economic arguments. And that's what's really accelerated things now. And what makes it interesting in BNP Paribas, I would say from my, you know, I've been with the bank now for 12 years, and I've had various different roles in this bank, from product development to sales, to now specifically doing research inside of an economics team around sustainable finance. And that role did not exist before me. I kind of helped to create that role. And I would say one of the interesting things about BNP Paribas is we do view the world a bit differently than other banks, primarily American banks, in the sense that if we do see the opportunity to create a new business line, we give people a lot of latitude to kind of help create those business lines and to create ideas in the bank around how we can, you know, better serve our clients. So sustainable finance was one of the key ways that I could kind of contribute to that. And, you know, what I wanted to do was kind of contribute specifically thought leadership around that. So a lot of what I write today is market related, but it's going to be about how green bonds are developing, how carbon credits are developing. If there's a new instrument that's come on to the market, I'll explain to clients how that works and how that's going to factor it in. The ECB, as Rish was mentioning before, they invest about 25% of their QE programs are in green bonds. But recently, yesterday, there was an announcement that they were going to actually start to invest and take and accept as collateral sustainability-linked bonds, which is another instrument. So here's another case of how, you know, you're kind of explaining to clients what that means, what the ECB just said, and what is this instrument that's different than green bonds? How is that going to be impacted then as well? So sustainable finance is now obviously a very hot topic. Everyone's interested in it now, which is great because the previous 6 years of this, we did not have that. So the wind is definitely in our favor now, and the economics are in our favor. So the next decade is really going to be about sustainable finance expansion, almost in a way that we cannot fully appreciate yet because of the developments in terms of battery technology and carbon capture storage that we're going to see develop now, primarily because we do have stimulus packages now coming from the European governments. We have, as I was saying, the economic benefits before, but we also have lower cost of capital because there are more demand from investors now for green bonds. So all of these different sources of capital are kind of coming together at the right time for capital markets to really kind of make a strong push to expand the sustainable finance market. And what I would like to say in addition to that, like, you know, clearly I work in global capital markets for BNP Paribas. But sustainable finance in general goes well beyond global capital markets. So inside of BNP Paribas as a company, sustainable finance is now embedded fully in the insurance business, in the asset management business, in the real estate business, in the custodian security services business. It's even embedded into our car leasing and Arval solution around that. Obviously, in risk and compliance, once again, that's key there. So what I would say for BNP Paribas, as Rish was kind of saying, follow your passion. If your passion is for sustainable finance, that's fantastic. There are various different avenues that you'll be able to pursue inside of BNP Paribas. So feel free, reach out to us, talk to us about it. We do a lot of different teach-ins, and personally, myself and my team, we publish a lot of different papers around sustainable finance. So certainly look for Markets 360 research. And, you know, if you have questions, more than happy to take those now or later on. And with that, I'll pass back over to Rob. Thank you.
Thank you, Trevor, for that. Right, so the next part of the evening, I'm very excited to introduce Laurent. Laurent is actually sponsored, supported by the BNP Paribas Foundation. This identifies exceptional talents across many fields, including arts, sports, and music. Laurent has recently been named Jazz Magazine's French Musician of the Year, and they actually recently featured him on their February 2020 cover. So firstly, Laurent, welcome. Thank you for taking the time to be with us this evening. Obviously, what we'll do, I think, beforehand is ask you a couple of questions around yourself and the sort of BNP Paribas Foundation, how they support you, and then hopefully sort of play some music for us afterwards. So for the group and everyone here, why don't you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your background and how you got into the sort of jazz side of the world.
So, yeah, hello. Thanks for having me. It's like pretty new for me. It's like, yeah, funny. I hope it's going to be good because my English is not like very terrible, but I hope you understand. So I'm Laurent Coulondre, so I'm pianist, jazz pianist from France. I had two Grammy, French Grammy Awards, like the jazz musician. And yeah, it's funny because I never mind, you know, to have a bank to help me, you know, to help me, to help jazz music. For me, it's like, you know, pretty amazing. And I met the BNP Paribas Foundation 5 years ago when I was playing in a jazz club in Paris. And we made like a private gig. And I saw this. I was like, yeah, oh. It was like amazing, you know, a bank organizing for you a showcase to show your new album. And I was like, wow, it's going to be cool. So it was like 5 years ago, and 3 years ago, I was playing in Africa and Senegal. And I met Mathilde from the artistic director of the foundation. And we speak about this. And last year was the beginning of my story of foundation of the foundation. So maybe I can jump in the second question or something.
So, Laurent, why don't you go into a little bit more detail about how the foundation has supported you up until now?
Yeah, I was like 1 year from now, and it's really simple. Now, when I think about the project, I think about something. I'm not thinking about produce it or make it. I just have to make it, you know. It's like a background would change everything. Yeah, it's like, you know, if I want to record an album in Brazil, I just can make it. Well, maybe from now is not the good time to make it, but I can make it because I have the background and I have the foundation. We can help me for this. And as a musician, as an artist, it's like to have no limits in your project.
Yeah, I was going to say, to add to that question as well, it's like, how much freedom does the foundation give you? Do they support you on a day-to-day, or that you're sort of left to your own devices to sort of produce what you want to produce?
Yeah, it's like it's not just from no. It's like when they support an artist, it's like at minimum for 3 or 6 years. So they can help you when you have a project. They can help you, and you have a budget, you know, for the years. Every year you have the budget, and also when you made concert or you made some showcase, they can help you buy CDs. They can make promotion. It's like a global help, you know. I'm not sure. I'm clear, but yeah.
Yeah, no, I get that. Yeah.
Sorry.
And in terms of your journey up to now, what would you say your sort of biggest career highlight would be up to now? So your greatest achievement, would you say?
I think it was the playing to open for Sting. Yeah, I think it's the best thing that I met, because I was playing like my trio, you know, jazz music, and just before Sting. And there was like 10,000 people. And yeah, it was like a gift, you know, and you are playing and there is all the people, and you met Sting, and Sting check you. And yeah, I think That's more I think this is, yeah.
Yeah, and then in terms of the sort of next steps for you, what are you looking to sort of produce or make music in the future? What's your sort of future plans?
So, my idea of record an album in Brazil is not I'm thinking about this, and I'm thinking about making a big project, you know, with a lot of musicians on stage. And this, every time is hard because, there's some musicians, so it's more expensive and you can't travel. And I think because from now I'm just trio duo project. So from now I think I'm going to project to make some big stuff. Yeah.
Perfect. Well, I think that leads on to, I think you're going to play some music for us now, aren't you, Laurent? I did offer my services, but unfortunately he said he'll be doing it on his own. So Laurent, if we'll pass over to you. So if you want to get yourself set up, and then guys, what we'll do is Laurent will play for us very quickly. And then what we'll do is we'll go back to the guys from Sustainable Finance. And if you guys have any questions at the end, we'll ask you to raise your hand and we can put the questions to the team. So without further ado, Laurent, over to you, sir. Perfect. Cheers, Ron. Thank you very much for that. Yeah, not as nervous as in front of Sting then, no? Well, thank you very much. So what we'll do is we'll open the floor for some questions. I've got the guys here till just after 5:30. Paola Centola, do you want to start with you first?
Yeah, thanks. Hi. Thank you all. Thank you, Sarisher. Thank you, Trevor. Thank you, Rob, for hosting this. I had a question about the attractiveness of the business. I wanted to know right now which are the enterprises which are more interested in sustainability and green bonds, for example. Is it something more institutional or it's more corporate related?
Trevor, do you want to take that or shall I?
I can start if you want to start. In terms of, we mainly deal with institutional clients. So in terms of green bonds, what we're seeing is you kind of have a spread throughout the market. Historically, what we call SSA, which is supranational sovereigns and agencies, mainly governments, primarily is what we're talking about there. We're kind of the leaders of green bonds. So, you know, when we saw the first issuance of a green bond, it was actually from Poland in that sense, in terms of a government or a large institution like that. France was second. And this is really where we started to see some of the billion US dollar issuances coming through, the larger green bonds in that sense. Before, they were primarily driven by construction banks and development banks in that sense. But what we're seeing now is it's much more equally spread throughout the market. And certainly this year, the amount of corporate green bonds in particular has grown substantially, and that's largely been due to green projects being undertaken primarily around renewable energy. And that goes back to the comment I made with solar and wind now being economically viable and competitive with natural gas and coal. And that holds true for China, it holds true for Europe, and it holds true for North America. So in terms of that, we have seen a lot more corporate issuance this year, and we think corporate issuance will continue to rise, but right now earmarked for next year, the ECB is set to start issuing around 265 billion US dollars in green bonds. Now, to give you an indication, 2019, there were 240 billion US dollars of green bonds issued for the entire asset class in that sense. So over the next few years, the ECB will actually issue more green bonds than all of 2019. This means that SSA, or those kind of central banks and governments, will still be the predominant conveyor issuers of green debt. But we are seeing, because it's become more economically viable, that we do expect more corporates to kind of to make up a larger part of that in that sense. So Rish, if you have any comments, I'll hand over to you.
Mine's more for where people can find out information as well. So the website that I put at the end of the presentation has some really interesting case studies. If people are interested, both from the investor side and also from the corporate side. So the most recent one I can think of was a really interesting green bond with Daimler, the auto company. And it was really scientific in the targets that they picked as well. So I'd encourage you, if you're looking for stories around sustainable finance corporates that are shifting, head to cib.bnpparaba.com. I don't know if we're sharing the presentation after, but there's a lot of interesting case studies on there that could be useful if you're wondering kind of where that issuance is and also what it means for the market and broadly for transition as well.
Next question, Jinran Wang.
Hello. I'm a student from Universal Leeds Graduate. I'm really interested in sustainable finance. And in my I found the in this graduates, there are no specific program for students, like which area or division go for me.
I think I understood that as if you were interested in sustainable finance, which division would you work in? So I'd actually say it's the other way around. So you can do any job in finance and try and be embedding sustainable finance, which sounds like a controversial thing to say. But essentially, you know, Trevor's a fantastic example of this. So even now, I think he's redefining the way that research is done in the bank, because he's integrating that within the function of research, which never existed before. And I think it's the idea that we've got a fantastic training series now that we've just launched as a bank called Sustainable Finance, It's All About Your Business. Because actually every part of the bank, whether it's a coverage banker, an infrastructure banker, a credit analyst, a sales person for leveraged loans, whoever you might be, sustainability has a role to play in your job. And I think part of that stems from the fact that the bank itself is so engaged on this topic and driving the agenda. So I would not encourage any of you to say, I want to work in the team that does sustainable finance. I'd say I'd encourage you to work in the bank and make it more sustainable, because I think doing it the other way around means that you're simply chasing a tail. And actually to really change the culture of the bank, everybody needs to realize it's their job to do sustainable finance. And I'd say we're getting to that really interesting stage as a bank where we are integrating it at that level.
Yeah, and I would just comment to support Rish there that back in 2017, we took a strategic plan to actually integrate sustainable finance into our business and how it differs. If you look at a bank such as Bank of America or Citigroup, they have specific sustainable finance teams that are kind of carved out. We took a different approach in the sense that I literally sit with a group of economists that do ECB and Fed watching all day and talk about GDP. My job is to kind of integrate sustainable finance into that thinking in that sense. So we didn't necessarily carve out sustainable finance, as Rish was saying. We very much put these into all the key organizations with champions that are basically there to help educate our team around us into incorporating sustainable finance. So this will sound strange, but hopefully in 5 years, you know, we don't necessarily have sustainable finance analysts. We just have G10 rates analysts, for example, that view green bonds as any other asset class. And it's just a natural part of their analysis in that way. So we've taken a very different approach that I would say, you know, supporting Rish there, any role you have within BNP Paribas will have a sustainability element to it if that's what you want to focus on. You will have kind of the freedoms to take more of a sustainable finance slant, whether you're in a quant role or a sales role, or whether it's in a compliance or a risk role. It's kind of up to you to kind of take that impetus, but it will definitely be available to you in that sense.
Perfect. Thank you. And then Joshua, your question next, sir.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we got you there.
Thank you so much for the talk, everyone, and Laurent for that incredible performance. Trevor, what you were just saying actually leads beautifully into my question. I was actually wondering, because being as the sustainable finance space is very much nascent, and a lot of companies in particular have their own, I suppose, esoteric means of projecting their sustainable data and the moves that they make to try and have, try and align to their sustainable targets. I was just wondering what's the, I suppose, ideal future would look like in terms of being able to truly ascertain what is sustainable, what the sustainable move is and not in companies, whether it be in a corporate space or financially or et cetera, rather than just having, you know, a list of targets and not made up, but cooked ESG indicators that could more or less just be greenwashing. Like, what would that look like in a true sense the next few years?
Well, you know, I think the key metric there is really going to be aligning to the Paris goal of 1.5 degrees centigrade. You know, basically the Paris Accord set out two goals, either alignment to basically not having the Earth's temperature increase to no more than 2 degrees by the end of the century, or having it increase to no more than 1.5 degrees. Now, the 1.5 degree scenario is much more ambitious, but that's the one that's actually winning out now. So what I would say is in terms of, I wouldn't necessarily worry about greenwashing too much. What I would worry about more is how are companies going to be able to actually show that they're on a pathway to align themselves to a 1.5 degree trajectory. And I think Microsoft is an interesting example there. So what they've done is they've laid out key milestones. So by 2025, Microsoft basically wants to use 100% of its energy from renewable sources. By 2030, they want to be net carbon negative, which is basically meaning they're taking carbon out of the system through their business operations. And by 2050, they plan to have completely erased the entire carbon footprint that Microsoft would have ever created during its operational lifetime. So I think that's quite an ambitious goal, and that's a good model for companies to look at. Not only how do you become carbon neutral, how do you go far enough that you've actually erased the entire carbon footprint of the history of your company? And Microsoft is obviously, you know, a younger company than a lot of the other carbon intensive ones that we're thinking about out there. But I think what's key as well that we always push with companies is this is not about an overnight event that's going to take place. You know, we're very big on transition. We're very big on the just transition. We have to remember that when you turn away from coal, when you turn away from fossil fuels, you are turning away from people that are also employed by these companies as well. So we have to focus on, you know, how do we start to retool and re-educate people that are in heavily fossil fuel heavy emitting industries like that? And how do we actually provide these companies with a viable future that they can transition to themselves? So when we look at a lot of the energy companies and the utility companies out there right now, there is a clear bifurcation that we're seeing between European energy companies and utilities and North American oil companies and utilities. And the North American companies are very much, they see a future of natural gas still being a heavy player in there. Where you look at the economics of natural gas in Europe, it just does not make as much sense to kind of push that agenda there. So I think the key markers you want to see for the future is, you know, a continual drop in the price of solar energy is going to be a key marker. That's going to slow down, but as long as it, you know, it remains competitive, that's going to eliminate any chance of kind of conservative governments reducing any kind of regulation that's going to make fossil fuels more competitive again. So we want to see, you know, more economies of scale for solar. We want to see increased economies of scale for wind. Wind is actually slowing down now pretty considerably. The economies of scale there have been roughly flat for the last 3 years. It's still cheaper overall than coal in most places in the world, and certainly competitive with natural gas. But we want to kind of see this increase again. And then the last one I would really mention is going to be about around battery capacity. We need to see a significant amount of battery capacity increasing. If you look today at electric vehicles, Tesla, the reason that it's a leader, it not only does it make cool looking cars that are electric, it also makes cars, three different models that have a range over 700 kilometers. Second place is actually Volkswagen, and that may come as a shock to some of you who remember Dieselgate or have studied about Dieselgate in 2015. But Volkswagen now, they have five different models that have a range over 500 kilometers. But really, when we see people trying to make a transition to an electric vehicle, the three main concerns are firstly price. The cheapest electric vehicle you'll find on the market today is about 20,000 pounds. Sorry, 20,000 euros, actually. And the biggest subsidy that we're seeing right now is around 9,000 euros in Germany. The cheapest diesel car you could buy today, brand new, is about 8,000 euros. So even with that subsidy, you're still not getting the price of the electric vehicle down. So we need to get those prices down pretty significantly. When we look at Tesla, it's a very interesting company, but it is very much a luxury car company. So we have to start thinking about battery technology increasing in terms of the amount of storage, but also reaching economies of scale where we can start to put batteries into a Peugeot 106 and it makes economic sense for someone to be able to buy that. So those are the key indicators, at least in an environmental sense that I see. Obviously, you know, we're moving into broader terms here, but looking at oceans and plastic, circular economy is going to be a key one. How do we actually keep the plastic out of the oceans by actually reusing it and putting it into other supply chains where it can actually be reused again instead of just, you know, kind of recycled or, you know, thrown away and not necessarily really reused? We have to think about when we see those product labelings on packagings for plastics, for example, you can't recycle plastic endlessly. So recycling plastic is great, but it does come to an end at some point where you can no longer actually recycle it because the different plastics do not mix well together. They basically become degenerative over time. So these are the next keys that we have to look at, is really around circular economy and how do we continue to be able to reuse recycled materials as opposed to continuing to use virgin materials in that sense. So I would say, yeah, keep those in mind, cost of renewable energy, battery capacity and economies of scale of batteries, and the onset of circular economy as kind of the key three indicators to keep in mind. And I'll pause there for further questions. Or Rish, if you have a comment you would like to make as well, I hand over to you.
I think you covered it very, very comprehensively, Trevor. So yeah.
Yeah, and then if we have our final two questions, that's okay. So is it Salma, if you could go next?
Hello, everyone. So my question, you talked a lot about green bonds and how they're growing continuously. So I was wondering, how do you expect the growth of other financial products in the global market? I mean, I hear a lot of talk about carbon options. Is BNP working on other green financial products? Does this product see the same rate growth?
I could chip in here, Trevor, sure. In terms of the mindset side, because I think often when people hear sustainable finance, they jump product straight away. They're like, oh, a green bond, a sustainable bond, a sustainable loan, carbon offset. But actually, I'd say that what we're as a bank doing is taking, and I guess Trevor will go more into the product detail, but I think the way that we're being engage with our clients is actually the step before that, to understand what is their sustainability strategy, how can they transition their business, and crucially, what products are then suitable for them to engage with us as a bank on. So Trevor mentioned earlier the fact that, for example, we as a bank, especially in the UK, have, you know, 9 different business lines, really transversal. So it's not only the investment bank that might have green bonds, green loans, but if you're, for example, a large supermarket or a car company, you might not just want to do a green bond or a green loan. You might also have a huge vehicle fleet that you want to have electric vehicles for. You might also have machinery which you use to wrap the products that you create. Therefore, you might need leasing solutions. So I'd say that people are often quick to jump to what's the next product and what's the big area. But I'd say that differentiator as a bank is the diversified platform that we have, because we really then sit with the client and say, what is it that you actually need to transition your business? I guess, Trevor, I don't know if you want to add more on the specific global markets aspect, but I'd say that from a CIB and a group level perspective, it's far more holistic than just jumping to a specific product.
Yeah, I would just add in terms of that, you know, we cover all the main products out there. And I would say even in addition to that, we're actually creating products. And what I mean by that is, for example, earlier this year, myself and the EQD team, the equity derivatives team, we created a transition basket for ESG, using ESG ratings as part of that, but also looking at it thematically. So in terms of transition, what we thought about is we're entering the fourth industrial revolution. So what is going to make companies, what are the key business lines inside of companies that are going to really help them perform in the fourth industrial revolution? And the two areas there are obviously around digital and sustainable finance or renewable energy in particular. So we actually ended up creating a long-short basket, going long companies we think are going to be successful in this transition and going short companies we think are less likely to be successful in this transition. But, you know, that's part of a structured product that we can then go out and sell to clients. You know, we can tell a story around that. What we're seeing is across the board, there is significant growth in all of these products. What you're basically seeing is you have clients at different levels. Some clients are very advanced and have been looking at sustainable finance for many, many years. Some are very, very much just learning about the topic now. And the primary reason they've been talking or learning about the topic now is going back to that chart I shared before, where we actually saw a 40% increase in the amount of purchases going into equity funds around ESG. If we compare that to the same amount of inflows going into U.S. equity funds over that same period, you had about an increase of about 5%. So ESG-specific ETFs this year are seeing an 8 times the amount of subscription and investment that traditional U.S. equities are, during a time where we certainly had a huge technological boom and biotech boom in the U.S. So it's a very impressive stat in that sense. So yes, it's really across the board. We're seeing tremendous growth in all the sustainable finance products. So back to you, Rob.
And then final question for the guys. Let's go. Is it Sabah Sharma?
Thank you so much for the talk again and the performance, by the way. It was so nice. I just have a question kind of leading on from Josh's question and the one before that. What you think specifically are the challenges in terms of ESG financial products, so whether that be unity on regulation or less ambiguity in terms of regulation, or whether it's transparency by different corporates in that sense?
So I'll start off here. And transparency has been something that a lot of people have been harping on. I really think that transparency is naturally occurring now because it's almost, you can't do ESG without transparency. So companies are owning up to that more and more. And to be fair to them, they're actually recognizing that if they are transparent and they have a story to tell, this can be quite powerful in the market. So I think transparency in a lot of ways will take care of itself. I think the what we need to see is twofold. One, regulation is helping, but primarily during this time where we're in a significant economic downturn, we have this ability to kind of start to rebuild in a green way. So what's key for that is cost of capital. And if institutions like the ECB and various governments can continue to issue green debt, this will, one, ring fence those proceeds so they can only be allocated to green projects, but two, it really reduces the cost of capital. This will have a magnitude effect or a multiplying effect on companies, because that cost of capital is cheaper for them as well if they're borrowing, and there's overall demand in the market for these instruments such as green bonds. So it's really kind of a perfect storm in a sense for renewable energy to kind of take off. So as long as the governments can continue to issue, you know, more debts and support that, and in continue to kind of bolster the regulation in terms of either the amount of carbon credits that are coming out of the market each year to force companies to either buy more expensive carbon credits or find ways to decarbonize, or, you know, purely taking cars off the road in terms of the age of the car and whether, you know, you're letting diesel vehicles into major cities on a daily basis, or if you're actually excluding them for some days, like France is now excluding diesel vehicles on the first Sunday of every month. You know, these are the initiatives that governments can really help with. On the corporate side, you know, the corporate side is really going to be driven by economies of scale. At the end of the day, if you can prove that ESG or sustainable finance is good for your company because it's going to help you make money, that's going to be the polarizing issue that's really going to take that forward in that sense. And Rish, I'll give you the last word.
I guess I see the challenges from quite a behavioral perspective. So, for example, if you look at the Bank 2030 report that Cambridge produced, and also the research that I've done as well on the masters, it shows that there's a huge knowledge gap, both in the industry and also inter-industry. So, for example, when we do create financial products for the likes of car companies or companies outside of a traditional environmentally minded sector, then we really have to understand the challenges in that sector. And that requires a huge educational shift, but it also requires a mindset shift, because finance doesn't have all the answers. And I think often people think that the innovation is going to come from finance, but we're seeing completely different alliances now that are showing that that's definitely not the case, that finance can work alone. So the bank has actually signed up to many initiatives in terms of those alliances, both with other banks like Principles for Responsible Banking, but also extending out to, for example, engaging with people like the Science Based Targets Initiative, other organizations that are really at the forefront of this inter-industry discussion. So I think the challenges are both operational and structural in many of the things that Trevor said. And I'd say that behavioral is the third one, because we really have to have a huge level of upskilling across multiple industries and a huge amount of knowledge sharing and collaboration. And traditionally, firms don't do that. They compete. It's really redefining economics in some respect, because I think traditional microeconomics is firm level competition theory. And that's just not the case anymore, because you're seeing alliances that have never taken place and are really at the forefront of progressing sustainability. So yeah, I don't know if that makes sense, Trevor, from your perspective too, but I think we're seeing quite an interesting shift in that side as well.
Yeah, no, I completely support that. Yeah, the behavioral change is going to be an important one. You know, just to throw a stat in there, people in London, you have basically 25% of people in London recycle today. So there's a key behavioral change that is very low hanging fruit to try and, you know, get people to shift. But it's just that mindset, as Rich said, you know, it's not something that you were necessarily, well, a lot of this audience probably would have been brought up in a different mindset in that way. But, you know, this is still something new that we're dealing with that hasn't necessarily always been, you know, on the foreground of how people think about their daily lives and the choices they make when they go to the shopping market, or they buy a car, or they choose to go on holiday. But these are now, you know, all options that, you know, certainly we see the younger generations embracing and taking advantage of. So a lot of hope for the mindsets has already changed in the younger generations. It's kind of seeing if we can get the mindset to change in some of the older generations, maybe.
Perfect. Well, on that note, guys, I think we'll end there. First of all, thank you very much to the business for attending to this evening. It's been very much appreciated for your time. So thank you very much. I think the session has been really, really successful. So I'll probably touch in with Trevor and Sarisher at some point and maybe look to book something further in the future, because you've still got, there's 22 questions there. So I don't think we're going to do those tonight. So maybe we'll put another session, guys, for those interested in attending. Laurent as well, thank you very much for tonight's your performance. It's been good to speak to you.
Thank you.
Yeah. And guys, thank you very much for attending. I hope you had a little bit of insight about, you know, what we do here at BNP Paribas. And I hopefully look to see some of your applications in the near future. So from me, thank you very much. And hopefully I'll speak to some of you very soon. So thank you.